It gets interesting when people try to explain what Jesus said, because it's recorded for us exactly, literally, what he said and what he meant. But sometimes people don't want to do what he said to do when he was making statements that required us to do something. You see, it's easier to make Christianity into a religion of laws and regulations and, you know, ways of doing things that we try to fix ourselves, than it is to take the person of Jesus as the Son of God, as living and alive, as being resurrected from the dead, as doing all these things that we can't quite grasp and get our hands on or understand, because we don't see it every day in our normal day-to-day living. But to know that he is God and he's the Son of God and he rose from the dead, and then to actually have him say something that wants us to do something that he's telling us to do, that's easier to put into religion than it is to take it as a literal person telling us what to do. Because you see, we could go to our church and we could make up rules and regulations and we could kind of use them as guides to live by, but that's not the same as having actually an experience of knowing God and having him tell you something, and then you have to deal with it. Because people will tell me all the time, they'll say, oh, if I could only talk to God, if I only knew that God was real, if only, hey, what if God is saying to you what Jesus said? What if Jesus is the Son of God? What if on the Sermon on the Mount, he literally is saying what he said? See, that's why we're examining the Sermon on the Mount, because we know these things if we're Christians. Because the people that were following him for a reason. Some of them saw miracles. Some of them thought he might be the Messiah. Some of them thought he might be what he claimed to be, the literal Son of God. Some of them, even his disciples, just really didn't have a clue completely of what he was saying. They just kind of like went along with it because nobody ever spoke like him. And he suddenly comes up onto the mountaintop, brings them all together, and he says all these statements that he makes. And he speaks as no one they've ever heard before, and they're shocked because they've already seen all the miracles. They've seen these things that demonstrated he's got quote-unquote power. But now he's making statements that are radical in the extreme. And then at the end of the Sermon on the Mount, he even goes to the point of saying, if you do these things, you will be like a houseman, be like a builder who builds a house upon rock, who takes and lays a foundation that's solid. And everyone knows that when you build a house, you want to build it on solid foundation, because there will be storms in your life. They will come. They will challenge your life. They will challenge you. They will challenge the house that you built. So if you built your house upon sand, obviously when the storms come, it'll wash away. Or you built it on a cliff, it may get washed off. Or you built it next to a river, it may get flooded. Or you build it in an earthquake zone, you know, it may get shaken. Or if you build it in the path of a hurricane, it may get blown apart. But Jesus says something interesting. He says, if you do these sayings of mine, if you do them, your house will stand. If you don't do them, it'll get destroyed. So he warns them at the end of the Sermon on the Mount, as well as teaching them through the Sermon on the Mount. He starts off by blessing them in chapter 5, and he begins to get into some real nitty-gritty, down-to-earth, practical realities that we're going to deal with today, right now, as we're listening and reading it, as we're beginning to understand Jesus says what he means and means what he says specifically, because he's dealing with you, and he's dealing with me, and he's dealing with the realities of him being God, and he can already see and know where we're coming from and where we're going. So when he spoke to them, he spoke, as they said, like one they'd never heard before. He spoke as one being in authority. And so whether we accept that authority or not, the question won't be what Jesus said, because we're looking at it. It'll be, what will you do with what Jesus said? So in the Sermon on the Mount, the biggest challenge is to do or not do as Jesus said, which is why he ended it that way. So in verse 27, it gets a little blunt, but we're only taking one part of it. We're just taking line upon line as it's versed out, the way we understand verses and the numbers, and we're looking at 5:27, and he says bluntly, you have heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not commit adultery. Whoa. You have heard it said. You see, Jesus didn't quote numbers and chapters and verses because, to put it bluntly, they didn't have chapters and verses and numbers. We added those way later into modern times, and sometimes they're good, and sometimes they're not so good. So the way that it was written is the way that he's speaking. You have heard it said, because they were in and had heard the rabbis teach them. Their teachers had taught them by speaking it audibly to them and telling them that thou shalt not commit adultery. Whoa. What is adultery? Let's be real. Let's get down to the nitty-gritty of what Jesus is saying. You have heard it said of old time. You know what adultery is. You literally do know. Let's get real. Let's be honest. As a man or a woman, you know what adultery is. You know bluntly that it is committing a sexual act with an unmarried partner. That you are committing an act that, if you're married, then you're committing adultery. And you're doing it with someone else. Or you're committing adultery in the sense of, guess what? You're breaking a contractual agreement because you're becoming an adulterous person. Because, see, the children of Israel had been married to God. They had said they wanted to be a holy people. They said they wanted to be chaste and virgin to God alone, and they wanted to walk with Him, to talk with Him, to know Him in a personal way, to do those things He said to do. And then they did other things. And that's adultery. You see, adultery isn't just a sexual act. It can be a spiritual act that causes a consequence of breaking a contractual agreement. Adultery that God places before all of us isn't just a physical act that a man can make with sex. It's also an emotional act that man can make with his emotions. It can be also a spiritual act that you do as a person when you choose to not do the things you've agreed to do, and you make yourself adulterous by breaking those things. And you become contractually guilty of the law according to God as He sees it. And as He has laid it out in the Law and the Prophets. That's why they said, you have heard it said of old, because they've been explained everything. The Pharisees had laid out tons of rules, 613 mitzvot. They had come up with so many circumstances with which you could commit adultery that even to very go beyond it, they had every physical way of defining adultery. Then they had exceptions, because after all, they couldn't keep the law either, so they made up exceptions of the way you could get around adultery. That you could, if you did this and say that it's this, then we'll pretend like it's this and we'll say that God accepts it, and then we'll go ahead and make it okay. Because in their own way of thinking, they wanted to protect from the actual act by making it okay to just kind of sidestep it. Like, okay, let's say you were in a business agreement, you know, and that you would agree to work for a person for a certain amount of quote-unquote money, but then you took that monies, you know, and you were supposed to buy, let's say, oh, I don't know, maybe 16 plants or maybe 16 pieces of lumber to build a house. And so you said, oh, but you know what? God's house needs some lumber, so I'm going to go ahead and, although I told my boss I was going to take the 16 pieces of lumber, I'm just going to take 8, and I'm going to give 8 to God. So it'll be okay if I do that, as long as I'm giving it to God, because then it's covered. And you see, that's lying, but it's also being adulterous in the sense of you've committed and broken an agreement that you had with God to be holy, to be with your boss, to do a job that you didn't function in doing what you were supposed to do, so you've gone off and done something else. But the reality of what Jesus is saying, the people knew, because the scribes and the Pharisees had already shown a way to have a harlot. You could have a wife, but you could have a harlot. You could go out and commit adultery because it was legal in some cases to pay a harlot and to not sin in the flesh because you had a hooker on the side. Oh, because you didn't want to be lustful, so you didn't want to commit the greater sin by doing the lesser sin, so you wanted to make sure that you don't do the greater sin by doing the lesser sin, so then God would say, it's okay because you're taking care of that. No. Jesus is saying, you have heard it said of old, thou shalt not commit adultery. He doesn't let you get away with adding the explanations. Jesus is saying, you've heard it said, thou shalt not commit adultery. So what I would ask you is, because we're going to get into the details of what Jesus says and get Jesus' opinion and Jesus' statement of what Jesus said to do, what do you say he said to you today? What is Jesus saying to you when he says, thou shalt not, according to what you've heard, according to what you've been told, according to what you know in your heart of hearts? This is all that we're making the point of right now in this one line. What has Jesus said to you, thou shalt not commit adultery? What does that mean to you? Will you do it or not? Do you commit adultery or will you not? See, that's the problem with what Jesus said, because he's making it direct. And it's up to you, according to what you've heard, about whether you will do or not do what Jesus said. Because you've heard it said, thou shalt not commit adultery. And he's going to explain it. But for now, today, as we're looking at just this word, this line, this scripture, this statement, do you know what Jesus said just now? Do you literally understand what the point is he's making? Do you grasp the fact that you have heard it said? He's saying you've heard it said. You know you have. I'm a man, you're a man, you're a woman, I'm not a woman, but I know too. Because you have heard it said, thou shalt not commit adultery. You know you've heard it said. Now you can try to compromise with the explanation. Maybe you'll get away with it. But you know what Jesus said, that you have heard it said, thou shalt not commit adultery. And now you also know what Jesus said, thou shalt not commit adultery. Because you know that's what God said. So today would be a question, just in this verse as we're devotionally looking at it. As you know, the next ones that will come will make it even more so real. But literally today, when you examine this in your heart of hearts, when you examine yourself, are you compromising in some way, making it not what Jesus said, to make it just kind of an idea? Or will you literally be honest, and that's all Jesus really wants from us, really, as people, as a people of God? Will we be honest before him and know what he said? Literally, is what he meant to us personally, because the literal is the personal, and that's what he's saying to me today. You have heard it said, thou shalt not commit adultery. I know today for myself what Jesus said, and he said for me today, thou shalt not commit adultery, and I know that I have heard it before, and I know what he's going to say soon. As we get into it, in a very real way. So for you, what did Jesus say? Remember, you need to examine that. Not just in context, because you can look at it anytime in context. But get deep into it and look right at it and say, what did he say?